Okay. Yeah, so as Tim just said, I want to talk about HDAC 4 or histone deacetylase 4, a nexus and translational target between lipid and glucose signaling in the failing heart. I start with this slide. So this is from a very nice review article that was written by Eduardo Bertero and Christoph Mark. And I think there were a couple of presentations at this webinar series that already talked about cardiac metabolism. I just, to jump into this topic, we all know that the heart uses fatty acids and more than glucose, but that during heart failure, there's a shift from fatty acid usage to glucose usage. What I want to highlight here is the little arrows besides enzymes and metabolites. And when you look at these arrows, you may realize that the changes in metabolic enzymes, and this is expression of metabolic enzymes, seem to occur in a very coordinated way. So fatty acid metabolism is generally downregulated, glucose metabolism is generally upregulated, but it's not used efficiently. Ketone bodies instead may be used. What I want to highlight here already is that when glycolysis is upregulated, that there are also side pathways that get activated. For example, the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway, which results in O-linked glycosylation of proteins, protein O-glucanoculation, I will call it. And this will be one thing I will talk about during this presentation. But if this is all true, that the gene expression changes occur in a regulated way, you may also ask the question, what are the coordinators, or I would like to call them epiregulators. Why epiregulators? There are epigenetic enzymes like histone deacetylases that were implied to play a major role in different metabolic processes. And this is in particular true for histone deacetylases. This is a cartoon, actually, I think it was made by Tim, and it's a little bit adapted. HDACs, as the name say, are histone deacetylases, but this does not only occur on histones, but also on other non-histone proteins. Also, the acetylation modification might be a little bit different from case to case, but this is not a topic for today. HDACs are divided in different classes of enzymes: class 1, class 2A, class 2B, class 3, and class 4. I put red boxes around the HDACs that are considered to be cardiodetrimental, and green boxes around enzymes that appear to be cardioprotective. This is mostly based on genetic mouse models. And for almost all of them, for sirtuins is pretty typical, but also for others, metabolic phenotypes are described. I'm very interested, or my lab is very interested, in the class 2A HDACs. There are different reasons. One reason is that they are enriched in cardiac myocytes, also in neurons, so in non-dividing cells. And there are other properties of class 2 HDACs that are, in my eyes, very interesting. And I want to go through my view on class 2A HDACs. First statement I want to make is that class 2 HDACs, or whether class 2 HDACs are really HDACs. The reason is that it was reported that the deacetylase domain is very low and almost not detectable, but the binding activity to acetylases is actually very high. So it might bind to the chromatin, but not necessarily itself or themselves remove acetyl groups. However, there is a very low deacetylase activity that we have measured recently. And this is an ongoing project in my lab I'm not talking about today, but I think there will also exciting results will come up from studying the deacetylase function of class 2 HDACs. Class 2 HDACs can recruit HDAC activity by recruiting class 1 HDAC. These are enzymes with very high deacetylase activity, and they can recruit this activity to certain chromatin regions. And the way they do it, they bind to transcription factors. The most famous one is probably myocyte enhancer factor 2, MEF2. And I think this is right, because in unbiased screens, we found a high enrichment of MEF2 binding sites in HDAC4 models that we use for SHIP sequencing experiments. Class 2 HDACs do not only transfer class 1 HTAC activity to certain chromatin region, but also other chromatin modifying enzyme activities, like in this case, SUF39H1, which is an histone methyltransferase. And we also have data for an histone arginine methyltransferase. These are PRMTs who also bind to HTACs and might be recruited to certain chromatin regions. One of the really interesting and also translationally interesting things is that they're highly signal responsive. And one example that was probably one of the first, and Tim was actually the one who pioneered this research, was found that class 2 HTACs can bind to 14 sweet sweet chaperones up on phosphorylation, and this leads to nuclear export or cytosolic accumulation. And this is driven by phosphorylation, by kinases, which then actually inactivate class 2 HTACs from the nucleus and bring them to the cytosol. One example, or this is one very classical example, it probably is one of my first experiments when I was a postdoc, or this kind of experiments. Here you see an HTAC that is labeled on the N-terminus by an RFP, the C-terminus by a GFP. And you see when you co-express HTAC 4 that you see here, together with CAM kinase, you see that it goes from the nucleus to the cytosol. This involves phosphorylation. We did, however, a second experiment. So we added another protein kinase that acts in the same pathway as CAM kinase 2 in the beta adrenergic pathway, which is protein kinase A. And when we added PKA in addition to CAM kinase 2, we found this red nuclei. So what did that mean? That meant that there was some proteolytic event between the RFP and the GFP, and that this N-terminal half was accumulating in the nucleus. So PKA counteracted somehow on CAMK2. And I will show you that this N-terminal fragment of HTAC4 has actually a function. So what I want to do today, I want to first talk about HTAC4 and lipid droplet associated signaling. You will see in a second what I mean with that. And then later I want to talk about HTAC4 and protein oligonucleation, then on HTAC4 and diabetes. And at the end, I have two slides only that should just show you that we can also pursue HTAC4 as a target in cardiometabolic disease. Okay. So we found that this proteolytic fragment of HTAC4 that I just showed you, this red nuclei, I think, is actually about 30 kilodalton, 28 kilodalton. That is this band that we can visualize by Western blotting. And by giving different protease inhibitors, here AEBSF, or only AEBSF was able to prevent proteolysis of HTAC4. Segeye in my lab, he was actually looking for the identity of this serine protease. He set up an siRNA screen with 130 different siRNAs directed against known but also unknown proteases, serine proteases. And he found one, which was called ABHG5. Here you see the knockdown of ABHG5, which was successful. That knockdown of ABHG5 was also able to reduce the production of this N-terminal cleavage product of HTAC4, which we call HTAC4NT. ABHG5 was not a known protease. It is actually known as a lipid droplet associated protein. It normally binds to perilipin under unstressed condition and is bound to lipid droplets. And up on beta-3 adrenergic stimulation in adipocytes, but also in other cell types, ABHG5 dissociates from perilipin, which is phosphorylated by PKA, and binds to ATGL. ATGL is a lipase, and the ABHG5 ATGL complex is actually an active lipase complex. ABHG5 has no enzymatic function in this process. ABHG5 is also important, and that can best be told by looking at very rare genetic mutations in patients. There's a very rare disease, it's called neutral lipid storage disease. Only a few hundred cases are described. And these mutations in ABHG5, but also in its partner protein, ATGL, result in a massive lipid storage in cells, in actually all cells of the body, but also in cardiomyocytes. And this leads to severe heart failure. And in some cases, only heart transplantation helps these young patients to survive. So there's human evidence that ABHA5 is important for the human heart. We generated cardiomyocyte-specific ABHA5 knockout mice that you see here. And we looked in response to beta-adrenergic stimulation, generally by isoproterenol, but also specifically beta-3 adrenergic stimulation, that this can all induce HTEP4NT, which was not in the same degree happening in the cardiomyocyte-specific ABHA5 knockout mice, kind of proving that ABHA5 is responsible for endogenous cleavage of HTEP4. We also did many experiments. I only show one, because this was a lot of effort we needed to put in to finally come to this result. So the question was obviously, is ABHA5 really a protease or is it an indirect mechanism? So we purified ABHA5 together with HTEP4 in insect cells, ABHA5 in E. coli. We were able to see this N-terminal product of HTEP4 in Eppendorf tubes when we put only the two proteins together, which was completely inhibited by the addition of a serine protease inhibitor, kind of proving that ABHA5 is indeed an active serine protease. We did also some point mutations that show that the catalytic triad that was predicted to be important for the serine protease function, it was actually important for its function. We looked at the phenotype more closely. It was kind of reported. ABHA5 loss of function leads to neutral lipid storage disease. And you see this massive lipid accumulation in cardiac myocytes that you can even see as a fat layer on an Eppendorf tube. And this is associated with cardiac dysfunction. So we decided to show what happens when we reintroduce HTEP4NT by adeno-associated virus 9-mediated overexpression. It was done with Oliver Müller. So we here put it back to normal levels. I don't have the Western blot, but believe me, we could increase, at least on Western, the HTEP4NT levels to the same degree as it was without ABHA5 knockout. And you see that there's no effect on lipid accumulation, but we were able to improve cardiac function. Kind of challenging the concept of lipotoxicity, at least in this early stage, as a cause for cardiac dysfunction. This is quantified here by looking at different fatty acid, linoleic acid, alanoic acid, oleic acid. You see it goes all up, but it's not affected by HTEP4NT reintroduction. But when you look for target genes of the transcription factor MEF2, you see that the increase of myomaxin or the increase of NUR77, NR4A1, it's just another name, can actually be downregulated. So gene expression changes are normalized, cardiac function is improved, but the lipid storage is not affected by reintroducing HTEP4NT in ABHA5 knockout mice. We also made transgenic mice, so we overexpress ABHA5 to this massive amount. It surprisingly did not affect the heart at baseline conditions. There was no phenotype. We challenged the mice with pressure overload, TAC. You see that upon TAC, actually HTEP4NT goes down. I'll show you that later again. And by just overexpressing ABHA5 this massively, we can actually prevent the downregulation. We were surprised to see that it doesn't go over normal levels, but it could actually stop the downregulation of HTEP4NT. And this is all associated, or this leads to an improved cardiac function. It is normally reduced after TAC to this degree. So ABHA5 protects from pressure overload induced heart failure. So that's the summary of the first part. This data were published a few months ago. So what we believe is that beta adrenergic stimulation by beta 1 and perhaps beta 3, we are doing genetic mouse models now to really prove this, because you know there's a debate whether beta-3 is actually expressed on cardiac myocytes. Our pharmacological data suggests this, but genetic evidence is still not provided, so we are making at the moment cardiomyocyte-specific beta-3 knockout mice together with Ali Elamouche and Dresden. We believe that this PKA is activated, phosphorylated leptin, ABLG5 associates with ATGL, and has itself an enzymatic function and cleaves off this N-terminal fragment, which inhibits transcription, most likely the myocyte enhancer factor 2, MF2, and this has an effect on cardiac function. We have a few data in this paper to explain this, but I want to explain the downstream mechanism with the following study. And that study was about SH4 and protein O-group methylation. So here you see that SH4NT levels actually go up, up on physiological exercise, which was a very interesting result. So we decided when SH4NT goes up, we need to use SH4 knockout mice, cardiomyocyte-specific SH4 knockout mice, to see whether this has any effect on performance up on exercise. And here you see that when we let them exercise, forced treadmill running, that in the beginning the exercise capacity is normal, but then rapidly drops down. And this is actually mediated by a phenotype that we called cardiac fatigue or transient cardiomyopathy. You see that 5 minutes after exercise, cardiac function is impaired, but this is in an interim time point, and hours after exercise, cardiac function is normal. So this is a transient, let's say, heart failure phenotype or an acute heart failure phenotype. Something what we also see in Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, which now Bastian Brunt is studying in my lab, and also other forms of acute heart failure, such as septic cardiomyopathy. We also see these changes. Lorenz Lehmann then also found that SH4NT, and I showed you that in the previous study, is downregulated in pathological stress situations, such after TAC surgery. So we thought, it is a good idea to reintroduce SH4NT not only in the ABSG5 knockout mice, but also in TAC-operated mice. And here you see one example experiment that this is a normal drop in our TAC surgery procedure after TAC. And then the mice also express SH4NT by AAV9. We can actually attenuate the drop of heart failure. We see not massive effects on cardiac hypertrophy, but a very strong effect on cardiac fibrosis and on cardiac function. Here I make a long story very short, how we found out what's happening downstream. So it started with a microarray. You see all the genes that are normally upregulated after TAC surgery in control mice. But when we re-express SH4NT, only a subset of genes is normalized in this expression. And among them are these 10 genes. They all are interesting, I believe. We focus on NR4A1 because that was the only one out of this list which turned out by chip sequencing experiment to be the only direct MEF2 target. And in further experiments, we found that NR4A1 actually induces the expression of GFPT2 or GFAT2 when we overexpressed it together in cardiac myocytes. So I don't show you the original data because it would take too long, but we actually could unmask this signaling pathway. SH4NT inhibits MEF2, that was known. That induced MEF2 would induce NUR77, and that would induce GFAT2. So GFAT2 is a rate-limiting enzyme of the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway. So we checked that hypothesis with different experiments. Here is one. So when we overexpress NUR77 or NR4A1, you see this overall increase in protein O-group methylation, which was also seen in the loss of function approach and also in experiments when we knocked out SH4 and did physiological exercise. So NUR77 induces the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway and protein O-group methylation. So the big question was, what protein is O-group methylated? The tools are not that easy. We first had a view on the cellular's compartment, and we found that the sarcoplasmic reticulum, that are the little dots here and based on the co-staining with calreticulin, showed a higher degree of O-group methylation in HF4 deficient mice upon exercise. And we also checked now, and that actually bases on an educated guess, because one protein on the SR that is known to be O-group methylated is STIM1, which among other calcium processes regulates store-operated calcium entry. And we actually could see that in HF4 knockout mice, actually for knockout mice, that there is a higher level of ogluconeculation of STIM1. We could then also show that this is not the short version of STIM1, but actually the long version of STIM1. There's one alternative splicing event, this exon, which was predicted to be highly ogluconeculated just based on motif analysis. And here you see that the smaller version, the upper one, is not ogluconeculated in co-IP experiments, but the longer version is very nicely ogluconeculated, which can also be modified by gain of function or mainly loss of inhibition of the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway by DON, which is a chemical inhibitor of the HBP. And this is one example. I'm not saying this is causative, but one feature of STIM1 is regulating the stereopurative calcium entry. And here you actually see that this is inhibited in HTEC4 knockout mice. And when we do a metabolic intervention by DON, which inhibits the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway, we can normalize this. STIM has other functions, and we are still puzzling, or we are still trying to figure out how STIM1 acts in this entire scenario. But what I can tell you by this engineered heart tissue experiment, in which we overexpress NO77, you can see the high calcium conditions, the drop in cardiac force development. And here you see when we only express STIM1N, so S, this is a non-ogluconeculatable version of STIM. And this one can actually rescue the NR4A1-induced contractile dysfunction. And we also did this experiment. We knocked out STIM1 and STIM2 because of redundancy. We did the double knockout, and we also did an exercise experiment similar to the HTEC4 experiment, and we also found a cardiac fatigue phenotype in these mice. However, later and not that pronounced, leaving the question open, what other mechanisms, I would say calcium handling mechanisms, would contribute to the cardiac fatigue phenotype in HTEC4 deficient mice. The summary of the second part is that I showed you that HTEC4NT inhibits MEF2, that is result we repeatedly see, and we now found that the direct target is NR4A1 or NUR77, which is known to control glucose handling and to initiate glycolysis, but an inefficient, in our view, an inefficient way of glycolysis, including the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway. This is now a new finding, which results in protein ogluconeculation. I showed you one example of protein ogluconeculation on STIM1. Which has many effects on calcium handling, which actually links to cardiac function, and its inhibition leads to cardiac dysfunction. This concept actually says that calcium handling problems can occur downstream of an epiregulation of a complicated epigenetic metabolic connection. Because of the findings on glucose metabolism, we of course became very interested in diabetes. So what we did next was we checked actually the, before I come to that, I give you a little introduction. You all know, first of all, people die from heart failure, but when you have diabetes plus heart failure, you die more often. This we all know. However, I want to point out something what is obvious, but I think it's worth to emphasize. Up on the diagnosis of diabetes, 20% of the patients within 2.5 years develop heart failure, which also means that 80% do not. And this is maybe trivial because it doesn't need to be, but it also tells you that maybe diabetes is not always bad for the heart. And this is actually underlined by the fact that lowering glucose levels by different anti-diabetics sometimes lead to worsening of heart failure. And I say that because we found this result. So we actually were expecting that the HTEC4NT levels, which are cardioprotective, would be downregulated in diabetic patients. We have here patients, human PBMCs from type 1 and type 2 diabetic patients. These patients were characterized by no cardiac complications and no other late diabetic complications. So here HTEC4NT was upregulated. And the same thing, that was really surprising, we found also in diabetic mice, in DB mice, compared here to the control heterozygous mice, we found that the HTEC4NT levels were actually upregulated. I really need to emphasize that these mice were not characterized by diastolic or, it's not shown here, but also not systolic cardiac dysfunction, as you see here. So these are, let's call them cardiac healthy diabetic mice. And these mice show increased level of what we think cardioprotective HTT4NT fragment. And here you see that we actually can induce, that was also a surprise, when we did cell culture experiments, we increased the amount of glucose and also of thymine G, which is an inductor of the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway. We can actually induce or increase the pKa-induced NT production. So glucose is actually doing something good here. So because of that, we thought, what happens in diabetic mice when they don't have HTT4? So first of all, we could here in this experiment, these are young mice after SDZ, and this is 24 weeks DB, we don't see systolic heart failure. And we do the same experiment in HTT4, cardiac-specific HTT4 knockout mice, we actually see systolic heart failure, which was quite pronounced. So HTT4 protects the heart from diabetic cardiomyopathy. Then we decided to bring back only the N-terminal fragment by gene therapy here, HTT4NT by AAV9, the same approach I showed you before. And we found that only the addition of the small fragment, 200 amino acid compared to 1,000 of the overall protein, was able to rescue the phenotype. So we can say that HTT4NT protects the heart from diabetes. And now I come to a few mechanistic insights, and we found actually that HTT4 itself is opleuconaculated. Also the endogenous protein by co-IPs, and here I show you an overexpression experiment, and by different bioinformatic predictions, we found that one candidate opleuconac site was serine 642, this site, which is 10 amino acids downstream from serine 632, which is the major KMK2 phosphorylation site which induces cytosolic accumulation. So you see the mutant protein overexpressed here and the wild type protein overexpressed, and only the wild type protein showed opleuconaculation of the protein with an antibody that recognized the surrounding regions. So we were able to make a mutant that is actually a mutation that protects from opleuconaculation. We now have also knock-in mice, and we are currently investigating 642A knock-in mice, and I'm very eager to see the phenotype in a couple of weeks. I should really pronounce and emphasize now that we believe that this is a protective event, and the KM kinase phosphorylation is a deleterious event. If this is the case, I think it's very interesting to understand whether these two modifications crosstalk. This is what we found. So first, we use a mutant, 642A, that cannot be opleuconaculated, and indeed you see higher phosphorylation levels of this deleterious KMK2 phosphorylation site. When we did the opposite experiment, and we actually added KMK2 to phosphorylate this site, we found that pKa was not able to produce HTT4NT to the same degree as without phosphorylation as 6V2. So here you see the phosphorylation is increased, and the NT production is decreased. So it seems that phosphorylation at 6V2 and opleuconaculation at 6V2 may be mutually exclusive. And we are doing some mass spec experiments, also targeted proteomics to really show, and also single peptide experiments to really show that on one peptide, only one event could occur versus the other, but we don't have the final answer for this yet. But at least these are events that inhibit each other to some degree. And since this is a heterocellular system, it is hard to say whether this is actually happening on the same peptide or not with the current methods used. But this is interesting because it leads to this model. So we think in the healthy heart, HTT4 is a lot in the nucleus and inhibits MEF2, and by this inhibits thereby leaves a physiological transcriptional control of the hexamine biosynthesis pathway open. When the heart is diabetic without complications, then the oligonucleation occurs here and predominates here and actually prevents the pathological phosphorylation. It leads to this protection by HTOP4NT. It leads actually to an adaptive transcriptional inhibition of the HBP. When the second hit is coming, for example, arterial hypertension or myocardial infarction or other forms of pressure overload, and CAM kinase is activated, CAM kinase will bind to this HTOP4-CAMK2 docking site. CAMK2 can be activated by O-glucoregulation, by calcium, by other PTMs, oxidation, and so on, and would actually inhibit the O-glucoregulation of 6V2, but would induce phosphorylation of 6V2 and would induce nuclear export and would abolish this cardioprotective event. And then the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway is completely unleashed and leads to maladaptive events. To summarize this last part is that we think that O-glucoregulation is, of course, like other PTMs, good and bad. And I now showed you two maladaptive events, which is O-glucoregulation of CAMK2, but also of STIM1. But O-glucoregulation of HTOP4 is actually causing a protective event, which leads to a negative feedback loop to actually decrease this signaling pathway, which leads at the end to would lead to cardiac dysfunction. Only two slides left, and I come to the end. I go shortly back. So when you look at this picture, and you would think you want to develop a therapy, so you could come to the idea you need to increase O-glucoregulation at 6V2. However, I have no idea to specifically do this. We can maybe stimulate the hexosamine biosynthetic pathway, but we would do good and bad things. And the specific mechanism why this is happening here is not well enough understood. We try to understand. So it's, I think, impossible to develop a therapy that specifically aims to increase O-glucoregulation by targeting this event or the enzyme that is doing it, because there's only one enzyme that puts an O-glucnac on a protein. However, this is inhibited by CAMK2. And here, there's a very specific event. CAMK2 actually binds to HTOP4 in a specific domain. So now I go to this. So I want to show you one approach, how we believe we can develop HTOP4 as a translational target in cardiometabolic disease. And that is by targeting the CAMK2-HTOP4 interaction. There's another consideration I want to just mention. We have unpublished data showing that CAMK2 is not only bad. CAMK2 is inducing also very many adaptive functions. And we did a screen in the German Mouse Clinic to look for phenotypes in mice that lack CAMK2 delta and gamma at the same time. And we found many maladaptive functions, in particular in non-cardiac cells, but in part maybe also in cardiac cells. So an idea is not to inhibit CAM kinase enzymatic activity in general, but actually to only inhibit the interaction between CAMK2 and HTOP4. So this is, I think, the translational approach that I want to propose. And actually what I think is the basis of a potential therapy is this docking site. So this is the site where CAM kinase 2 binds. That was shown here by these co-IP experiments. When we do mutations in this area, for example, at this arginine, we can actually disrupt the binding of CAM kinase 2 to HTOP4. And when we do that, you see that the nuclear export that normally happens after CAMK2 stimulation of HTOP4 is actually abolished when we take a mutant that cannot bind to CAMK2. Then you see that HTOP4 actually remains in the nucleus and is largely unresponsive to CAM kinase 2. We made a mouse model with this knock-in mutation on 601 arginine, still unpublished. But I can tell you this summary. In all mouse models so far, we tested HTOP4-601 knock-in mice. So these are CAM kinase resistant mice, or we also like to call them CAMK2 HDAC inhibitory compound mimicking mice, or CHIC mimics. They were actually protected after pressure overload, TAC, after ischemia reperfusion injury, also in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in a collaboration with Lucy Carrier, For the cam kinase knockout mice, they were also protected after pressure overload and post-MI, but for example, not in models of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, actually they die, and also not in other models of stress cardiomyopathy. This is the model for Takotsubo, broken heart cardiomyopathy. The other thing is that we found undesirable effects in cam kinase 2 double knockout mice when we delete them globally in all cells of the bodies, which we could not see in the chick mimicking mice. So our conclusion is that this approach inhibiting the interaction of cam kinase with SH4 is effective and safe, whereas the cam kinase inhibition might be only effective but not safe. So we did a small molecule screen by applying an alpha screen assay with two recombinant proteins, HF4, a fragment of HF4, and the entire cam kinase enzyme. And actually, we screened years ago already 80,000 compounds, and we found actually 96 hit compounds. And after many experiments, we found three singletons in hit validations that actually act can block the interaction between CAMP2 and HF4 in a low micromolar range in cell-based assays. We had a hard time to really find support to further finance this project, but we finally succeeded with the great help of the German Center of Cardiovascular Research, the DCHK. They are now helping us with enlarging the screen. So we are screening currently, we have already screened 300,000, and we will do other 280,000 in the next weeks. And we also got already funding for the MedChem phase to really do different cycles of hit to lead development to come at the end to an in vivo active lead compound that we can then use for proof of concept experiments in mice. This is all done with the Lead Discovery Center in Dortmund and financed by the DCHK. I think we are already talking to bioindustrial partners to then also doing the more expensive follow-up translational pathway. This is all what I wanted to tell you. This is of course not possible without many, many people that over the years worked in my lab and the key people doing experiments for this presentation were Segeye about lipid droplet together with Shamuka and Jens. Lorenz Lehmann discovered the O-glucoplication regulation by HF4. Maria Kohlage worked on diabetes and HF4 together with Johannes Grosso. Matthias Dewetter was involved in all these studies and a great mind and help to really finalize the experiments. We have many collaborators. Here's only a small selection of people who helped produce the data that I showed in this presentation. I'm very grateful to the funding agencies, and postdoc applications are very welcome to my lab because we still want to develop in the institute and want to continue to do this kind of studies. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Johannes, for a beautiful presentation. It's a great example of how mechanistic science can lead to innovative drug discovery approaches. And I really appreciate that. We have many questions rolling in through the Q&A box. I will read the questions and I'll attempt to pronounce the names of the people asking the questions, but let me apologize in advance for probably not pronouncing all of them correctly. So we're gonna start at the top. Triambak Basak has a question. What is the mechanistic role of O-glycosylation in heart failure progression? Is there any evidence available? Maybe O-glucnacylation? I'm not sure. What do you think, Johannes?
I think Triambak probably means this O-glucnacylation, if I may say. Please protest if I'm wrong. So O-glucnacylation is increased in heart failure. That is shown. What is the mechanistic role? Well, many proteins are O-glucnacylated, and I think we just only start to begin to understand the specific proteins that are actually O-glucnacylated and also to identify the sites. Obviously, we need to study PTMs. We need to do all these mechanistic studies and to do knock-in mutation and so on to figure that all out. I think we have some evidence that O-glucnacylation of STIM1 contributes to calcium mishandling and a decrease in cardiac contractility. I think there's a great paper of Don Burslab, Erickson, who showed that CAM kinase is overmaculated and contributes to CAM kinase activation in addition to oxidation, calcium calmodulin. And CAM kinase clearly is a driver of heart failure. Looking at the overall, the protein O-GlucNAC Western blots, you see a smear of protein. So you can imagine there are tons of proteins that are O-GlucNAC-ulated. And the big questions are, is that happening just by chance? Or are there specificity mechanisms? I believe there are specificity mechanisms, but we don't understand them yet. I think one explanation that they are specific is that there are cofactors that we need to identify that brings the OGT, the enzyme that puts O-GlucNAC on, to specific proteins. I also think it's very likely that PTMs in the neighborhood, like the phosphorylation on 6V2, also regulate the level of O-GlucNAC-ulation of different sites. So we need to also study the other PTMs. So it's a long answer, but this is the mechanism, the evidence that is involved in heart failure progression is only that there are increased levels of O-GlucNAC-ulation.
Thank you. Next question from Kevin Zhang. Why does ABHD5 regulation require lipid droplet involvement in your transgenic hearts? ATGL is drastically reduced. Any implication there?
Yeah, Kevin, good observation. Yes. Whenever ABHD5 goes up, ATGL goes down and vice versa. That is something what we find in these models. So they work together in concert. So my conclusion is that they compensate for each other. Why this ABHD5 regulation requires lipid droplet involvement? The short answer is, I don't know. I believe, based on all what we see, that it's not that simple. That's only ABHD5. I showed you an experiment in Eppendorf tubes putting ABHD5 and ACHD4 together. This was a really hard job to get this experiment working. My guess is that ABHD5 works in a protein complex that also positions ACHD4 in a way that cleaves at the right site, and that we need to understand. I would love to have the answer now.
Next question from Priscilla Sato. How far away does NTHDAC go beyond the NLS? Is it known which important alpha or beta binds in order to get through the nuclear pore complex? So how does NT get into the nucleus?
Right. So ACHD4NT does not contain the NLS. This is a little bit further downstream. We did initial experiments when we looked for ACHD4NT expression in COS cells, with and without MEF2. Whenever MEF2 was there, it went to the nucleus. When MEF2 was not there, then it was homogeneously distributed over the entire cell. I think it needs to bind to proteins that direct ACHD4NT to the nucleus. The exact mechanism is not known to me.
Okay. The next question is from Gabriella Sciatarella in Dallas. Hey, Gabriella. Great talk, Johannes. Couple of questions. Were you able to identify other targets that are cleaved by ABHD5? Second question, what causes the spontaneous cardiomyopathy in ABHD5 knockout mice? The absence of reduction in cardiac steatosis upon HDAC4NT overexpression in the knockout mice, despite improved EF, suggests that perhaps there's a non-lipid-based cardiomyopathy. Thank you.
Yeah, hi, Gabriele. Thanks, all great questions. We do proteomics and we do have some protein levels, but we don't really have other targets with a validation experiment that are cleaved by ABHD5, but we guess there are many, but we are still working on it. It's too early to tell. What causes the spontaneous cardiomyopathy? You can rescue by ACHD4NT. So it's an ACHD4NT-dependent mechanism. whether it's only, it's of course a good question, because when we knock out HF4, we don't see a similar spontaneous phenotype, but when HF4 and TE missing, we do see. So that suggests that there might be other targets. So that refers to your first question, that may amplify this effect, and that only re-addition of HF4 and TE is sufficient. I can only speculate on this. So this is a difficult question, but very important to study. So the absence of reduction in cardiac steatosis, yes, yeah, of course. And that was a big surprise. So there was, we looked at, you know, lipid general compound histology. We quantified single fatty acids, and they are not attenuated by HF4 and TE, but the cardiac function is. So I think that's a concept that in this early age, I want to say that lipotoxicity is the reason of cardiac dysfunction is challenged. So I think it's independent of that. However, when that would pursue over a longer time, I think that the lipotoxicity maybe destroys the sarcomeric structure. When we do electron microscopy in this stage of the mice, we see that there are lipid droplets, but they do not infiltrate the sarcomere structure. So it's kind of looks like a benign lipid droplet. I don't know how it will look like in later stages.
The next question is from an anonymous attendee. Please repeat, in the slide where you overexpressed ABHD5, the total level of HDAC4 didn't change. Was there a change in deacetylase activity that drove the downstream events?
Sure. Should I go back to that?
You can share it if you like as well, if that helps.
Okay. Right. Do you see my screen?
Not yet.
I cannot share, so I might. Sorry. So you are, the question was the HF4 transgenic?
ABHD5 overexpressor.
Yeah. This one. So when we overexpress ABHD5, we see indeed I think a very mild decrease of HF4, but mainly we don't see this downregulation of NT. That is what we observe. And I mentioned during the presentation that I was surprised that this is not going further up, because when we do it in cellular experiments, we actually see more cleavage than at the baseline level. So my simple idea here is that, and we see that HF4 usually is upregulated in pathological conditions, that this actually is maybe due to a reduction in proteolysis. So that is what this, if you put this together, then it makes this. But to be honest, we have not done really mechanistic experiments to really show this. And let me, what did you also ask? Yeah, the acetylation activity we did not measure. We need to. That's a good suggestion. Yeah, thanks.
Next question is from Helen Collins. Do you see a change in STIM1 ORA interactions, i.e., with ORA1 or ORA3 in HDAC4 knockout mice?
It was once on my list. We didn't do the experiment yet. And I this is a great question, because this refers to the fact there's a store-operated calcium, maybe the culprit or an independent effect. We have not done the experiment. I would love to do it at some point.
From Thomas Pulinkanil. Nice talk and great work. A few questions pertaining to ABHD5. Is ABHD5 specific to only HDAC4, or are other HDACs affected by ABHD5? And have you examined fatty acid uptake, oxidation, and free fatty acid levels in cardiomyocytes? That's number two. And number three, have you subjected the ABHD5 knockout mice to ischemia reperfusion, and do you expect them to phenocopy the TAC model? So maybe start with the first one. Does ABHD5 affect other HDACs?
We only checked for HDAC4, 5, 7, 9. It doesn't. So these are not cleaved. Other HDACs, I don't know. So we only checked for the class 2A HDACs. And the cleavage site and the ocular-crenulation site are both conserved to HDAC4, so they do not exist in the other HDAC. So I believe it's an HDAC4-specific effect. That's how it started, actually. We have measured some fatty acid in the cardiomyocytes, and that are increased. We did not look for fatty acid uptake and oxidation. We have also not done in that last part. No, we have not done. Have you subjected ABHD5 knockout to ischemia reperfusion? No, we haven't, but they develop spontaneous heart failure in a very short time. So we did not do, the TAC was done in the ABHD5 transgenics, not in the knockout. So the ABHD5 knockout develops spontaneous heart failure. The transgenic we have not subjected yet to ischemia reperfusion.
Thank you.
That is on the list. That is on the list. I believe that's on, that is ongoing, but it's too early to tell.
From Suresh Verma at the University of Alabama, Birmingham. Hi, Suresh. Hope you're doing well. He has two questions. One, do other HDACs compensate for HDAC4? If so, if not, why? And then number two, what signal determines whether CAM kinase 2 will induce diabetic heart failure?
Yeah, hi, Suresh. So also good questions. In general, HDACs compensate for each other. This we can tell by making double and triple knockout mice, so they develop spontaneous problems and spontaneous heart failure, so HDAC4/5. And also, I think I once tried the triple knockout, which was crazy, never published. So they certainly compensate. Whether they compensate for the exact same downstream pathway or whether this is just an accumulation of events, I don't know. They all obviously inhibit MEF2, at least HDAC4/5/9. For HDAC7, that was recently a very nice JCI paper of Sepp Halder questioned, so he could not find that HDAC7 inhibits MEF2. But whether this always happens in the same context on the same targets, that is also a question I cannot answer. I believe there's a partial overlap, but not entirely, based on the different knockout phenotypes. What signal determines that CAMK2 will induce diabetic mediated heart failure? So this is work done by John Burse. He showed that ocular-crenulation is actually the one that activates CAM kinase. And then it's also, there was a recent research paper by Don showing that reactive oxygen species are then produced. But clearly, ocular-crenulation upstream is increased in diabetic heart failure. Well, this is a $1 million question. Why is that bad for CAM kinase and why is it good for HDAC4? I really believe it depends on the context, on the timing, and that's why we are doing now time course experiments to see the ocular-CNAC levels of different targets at different time points of diabetes and also in the presence or absence of a second hit. I think that needs to be all sorted out. Yeah.
All right, from Lou Roderick. Hi, Lou. Great talk. The recapitulation of the fatigue phenotype and the STEM1 knockout points to calcium, of course. How similar is this to the MCU knockout where mice cannot mount a response to adrenergic stimulation? Do you see an effect on heart rate, so maybe a pacemaker effect? And have you looked at effects on mitochondrial calcium?
Hi, Liu. Difficult question for me, of course. Yeah, it points to calcium, but I try to make clear that I'm not sure what the exact mechanism is. So we use the store operated calcium entry WASA as a surrogate parameter to measure its function. The MCU, I cannot answer. I don't know the phenotype well enough. Sorry. Do you see an effect on heart rate? So maybe a pacemaker effect? Yeah, we do see effects on heart rate. Usually SH4 knockout mice tend to develop bradycardia. So it's also challenging to do the echoes. So we need to really train them and need to make sure that the heart failure doesn't drop down too much. We have not really done a systematic study on it. So I'm actually very curious to see. So I think one hypothesis we had in the lab is that maybe occlusive manipulation in pacemaker cells plays a role. That is something what nobody has studied to my knowledge. I would love to know this. Sorry, I cannot answer. Mitocalcium, we have not. Maybe Christoph Mark should do it, I think, but we have not.
From Luke Bertrand, excellent talk. O-glucan methylation is known to be increased in pathological hypertrophy where CAM kinase is also activated. So what happens in HDAC4 phospho-O-glucan ratio in such models where both pathways are stimulated?
It's ongoing. Thanks, Luke. Great question. It's ongoing. One student, one MD PhD student in my lab is now looking at all this. We have not the final answers. One challenge we really have, so when I say diabetic mice get heart failure when HDAC4 is knocked out, obviously is raises the question, is there an endogenous model to endogenously activate CAM kinase and then in addition to the diabetes, so a two-hit model. That is hard work. We are trying to establish that in the moment. And when we have these models, I think we can answer more of these questions.
From Alina Lenigapi, did you also check PPM1F, a serine threonine phosphatase, in these transgenic hearts? Because it regulates calcium chymogenin-dependent protein kinase 2 as one of its substrates.
Eleni, no, we have not. Sorry. Good point. I will ask that.
Next question is from my colleague, Kunhua Song at the University of Colorado. Great talk. Any ABHD5 mutations in patients that disrupt the interaction with HDAC4 but not its protease activity?
Hi, Kunhua. Great to. Thanks for the question. I don't know. We actually have a project in which we want to mimic, we want to mutate ABHD5. So we want to do all the human mutations and then want to do biochemical studies in an Eppendorf tube to actually look at these things. I agree, it is a great hypothesis that there might be ABHD5 mutations that only affect the HDAC4 mechanism and or the ATGL co-activation mechanism. And I think this is a really important question and will help us to understand the mechanisms much better. Answers so far we don't have.
All right, from Michael Kapiloff at Stanford. Hi, Michael. Great talk. How do the new mimics and the point mutation affect HDAC4 phosphorylation by other kinases besides CAM kinase 2?
Hi, Michael. I think I need to respond to an email of you. How do the mimic, what mimic do you mean?
Maybe the point mutation that disrupts CAM kinase interaction.
You mean the phosphomimetic that you've got, the mimetic that you've got, the protein mimetics, is that what you mean?
Can you maybe make that question clear and put it at the end so then I'm happy to answer. But if it relates to point mutation.
Because I think there was that mimetic that you're using for therapies. Is that what Michael's meaning?
I don't know. So for the 642, the O-glucan-NAC mutation increases the phosphorylation of HDAC4. So then we mutate 642 to a loss of function. By other kinases besides, I don't know. And we did not look at the PKD site. I think we looked at the 4-6-7. No, we didn't. We only checked the neighbor site. I don't know. Yeah.
So Michael just says he has the knocking mouse and the last part of the talk. He's just sort of added it at the end. Ah.
I think it's the mouse where you disrupted the CAM kinase interaction site.
The 601. Oh, I'm sorry. In that one, yeah, of course. So that was one of the keys. So that is an interesting experiment, and I should maybe have shown it. So it clearly reduces phosphorylation of 632 and 467 up on TAC. So when we do TAC on the 601, although CAM kinase, the mutation is far away from the phosphorylation sites, the phosphorylation of both sites is largely attenuated. So that was one of the biochemical proof of concept experiments showing that it really translates to the in vivo situation. Is that what you mean, Michael?
I think, you know, when you have that knock-in mutation, can PKD still phosphorylate HDAC4?
The 246 is not affected, so I believe it's specific for CAMK2. Jens Fielitz has done experiments on PKD binding on HDAC4 and 5 a long time ago, and it binds apart from this site. We are pretty sure that it's very specific for CAM kinase. So now I got your question, Mike, of course. So we can say that up on TAC, the phosphorylation of 467 and 632, which are both CAM kinase sites, are reduced in the knock-in mice, but not the 246. Okay. Suggesting that PKD is not affected. And another piece of evidence is that the PKD binding site is far away from the CAM kinase binding site between 246 and 467. We are actually trying to work on that too.
From Kamaravulu Yagavulu, great talk, Johannes. In the first part of your talk, the heart had a similar fatty acid profile, but no change in echo. What's the reason for this? And did you check cardiac fibrosis in these mice? These must be the ABHD5 knockout mice he's referring to.
Yeah, we did check fibrosis in these mice. They have fibrosis, but it's a mess to quantify because of all the fat. But I think we were able to show that there is fibrosis and that NT was reducing fibrosis to some degree. Might be wrong, but I think that was the result. I think it's a supplement of the paper. It was very difficult due to the fat. You had similar fatty acid profile, but no change. It had a change in the echo.
All right. Two questions. Do you want to address the echo part?
There was a reduction in the ejection fraction. If you talk about the knockout mice, the ABHD5 knockout mice, there was clearly a reduction of ejection fraction.
Two questions. Yeah, I think there was a reduction. So from Mick Lee, great talk, Johannes. What is the level of interaction between CAM kinase 2 and HDAC4 under normal circumstances? And what model did you use for the small molecule inhibitor screen?
There is an interaction between CAM kinase and HDAC4 to some degree, which increases up on TAC. How this is in absolute numbers, hard to say. It's regulated. This is an alpha screen. So we use an alpha screen for a small molecule screening.
All right, so from Emma Robinson. Hi, Emma. Thanks, Johannes. Given the gene expression of beta oxidation pathway players are reduced in genetic DCM, how much do you think the metabolic changes in the failing heart are secondary changes to pathological stimuli rather than the primary underlying causes? If secondary, how much will targeting the cardiometabolome help with curing heart failure, especially in cardiomyopathy patients with partially or totally pathogenic mutations and variants. This is a tough one, Johannes.
Yeah. Hi, Emma. Thanks for this. Okay, I need to read by myself. How much do you think the metabolic changes in the failing heart are secondary changes to pathological stimuli rather primary underlying causes? I think, of course, it depends on the mutation. You refer to sarcomeric genes, so then I of course think it's secondary. How that really goes, I think, is interesting to figure out. I mean, nobody would believe me, but I always see CAM kinase activation in different genetic models of dilated cardiomyopathy, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, in RBM20 cardiomyopathy, in laminopathies. It's always activated, and CAM kinase in our hands has profound effect on cardiac metabolism and favors glucose metabolism. This is one possibility, but I don't want to claim that this is the only one. But I believe that changes in signaling molecules then secondarily will affect the metabolic changes. But clearly this is interesting to figure out how that actually happens, because I am convinced that intervening with metabolic alterations would be a promising approach. If secondary, how much will targeting the cardiometabolome help with curing? Yeah, I think I answered this. I think that we need to understand to really use it as a translational strategy.
All right, the next question is from an anonymous attendee. I'm going to paraphrase a little bit here. CAM kinase can be activated by various stimuli, such as reactive oxygen species and intracellular calcium. Have you looked at the effects of these different stimuli on HDAC4 phosphorylation, nuclear translocation, and activity?
Good question. Not yet. We only have studied now proteases, kinases, but I am very interested in studying. Oxidation was done by Jun Satoshima. Very nice cell paper many years ago. Nitrosylation, I think, is largely unknown. Very interesting question, and I think worth to study.
Another anonymous question. Do we know if glucosamine administration regulates HDAC activity or transcript protein levels?
It was my first thought I had, but I have not done it until today. I don't know.
Yep. So Michael was just clarifying his question. Emma is now apologizing. Heinrich Zegmeier says, extremely excited.
Can I say if you give glucosamine to diabetes?
Now I've lost track.
Heinrich, I think you know the answer better of the question that you are asking. I don't know whether I can give safely glucosamine to diabetic patients with chronic arthritis. I don't know. I bet you know.
Well, Heinrich is still online, so you know he may be able to provide an answer if he's in time.
I think that's it.
That's all.
Only 24 questions.
There is one more question from Mark Pepin in the chat, if you're interested.
Chat is okay. Mark, hi Mark. Great discussion and excellent talk regarding the metabolic changes noted in the prior question. Would the role of HDAC4 as an epigenetic modifier contribute to an intractable metabolic switch in heart failure? That is what I think. That is what I think, that HDAC4 is modifying this switch.
But sort of in a permanent manner, through an epigenetic mechanism?
Yeah.
Or is it reversible?
I don't know. We have only done short term, and whether there are epigenetic modifications are mediated through the deacetylase domain, we have not checked so far. the signaling events that we describe should be reversible, depending on half-life times and so on. But the half-life of, for example, the proteolysis is very short, so it should be reversible. Cool, the correcting HFO would fit the metabolic perturbations.
Am I missing?
Yeah, it? I mean that is of course he's still that is of course what we wanna achieve. Yeah. So there are two ways now. So we do have a gene therapy approach of HFO-NT. And we are still working on that and patent and we'll go for it. So that might be one approach to really correct it by overexpression. I don't know whether gene therapy ever will make it to the clinic, to cardiology. And the other one is the drugs that interfere with the ogluknak event on HF4. Ogluknak is a very, very, very unstable modification. And so you would need really something what probably probably targets the surrounding regions to really prevent or drive ogluknakulation in a permanent way.
Unless I'm missing something, I don't see any additional questions. I see a lot of praise. Everyone loved your talk, Johannes. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim.
So Heinrich did provide the answer. He said, sorry, I do not know the answer. You will find out, Johannes.
I'm not sure.
Well,
thank you.
I would like to personally thank you, Johannes. I've learned a lot yet again today. So on my behalf, I would also like to thank you for a wonderful talk.
Thank you, Dava.
Thanks, everyone. Stay safe.
And Tim, again, thank you for chairing and for really, you know, giving us your great guidance on this. And everybody, thank you again. And we'll see you all tomorrow.